So I'm here with Stephanie De Palma, and we're going to be discussing your latest film, Catherine, and also your film career, both in Brighton and elsewhere. So maybe just tell us a bit about yourself first, Catherine, because I know you've just finished studying for a master's.
Yes. Yeah. I'm Stephanie De Palma. I'm originally from New York City, and I've been living in Brighton since 2012. Kind of came here, didn't think I'd stay as long as I did, and here I am. And yes, just finished a master's degree in documentary at Sussex University.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you've had a new film, Catherine, haven't you? Which is part of your course, wasn't it?
That was actually part of my course. Yeah, we had to do three different films. So one was a 6 minute, one was a 10 minute, and then the final dissertation film, which was 20 minutes.
Yeah.
So the 10 minute was Catherine, and that is about a young woman who is living with schizophrenia here in Brighton. And her journey, her progression through what she's had to deal with, she hasn't had an easy road, and how she lives with her illness.
Yeah, difficult subject matter. So how did you approach that? Because that's quite a tricky subject for kind of a master's dissertation, isn't it? A master's project.
Absolutely. To be honest with you, when I first met her, she just kind of bowled me over. And this is years ago. This is about 10 years ago I met her. And I just thought to myself, my God, she's absolutely captivating. And it's actually, I'll say that it was even before I knew that she actually had schizophrenia, I just thought, wow, she just really struck me as an interesting, multifaceted, lovely creature. And I just thought, you know what? And as I got to know her, her story began to envelop. And she didn't tell me at first about her schizophrenia even. It just came with time, and the layers started to unfold. And I just thought to myself, one day I will absolutely make a film about her and her life. And Sussex, it just so happened that this particular time in my life and in her life, it just all came together. And I said, all right, you know what? This 10 minute absolutely has to be about her. And it was, to be honest, it was easy in one sense because she trusts me and she knows me, but in another sense, it's quite difficult to obviously put your entire, be very open, very honest about some things that are very difficult to talk about. And yes, because we have the relationship that we do and that we've cultivated throughout years now, she knew that I always wanted to make some film about her. And, some days she didn't feel great. You know, some days the illness was really getting her down, but she wanted to send the message that she wanted to send as badly as I wanted to sort of do this film about her.
Yes, yeah. And this film is going to be shown in Brighton, isn't it? It's part of the Sin City.
Sin City Film Festival in November. Yeah, I'm really excited about it. Ever since Sin City kind of was born, I just thought, this is something I really want to be a part of. Personally, I love Brighton myself. Obviously, I haven't left. I thought I was going to come for a very short amount of time and end up staying years and years after. Yeah. So it's my home, and I always wanted to sort of give back in a way that is very personal to me, and this couldn't be any more special for me. Yeah.
So with Catherine, what did you find out about schizophrenia in particular? Because it's quite a debilitating condition, isn't it? And not many people work kind of full-time with that, do they? So
no.
How do they kind of navigate the complexity of the condition?
Well, I think it's different for everybody, absolutely. And now, through Catherine, I met other friends of hers who also became my friends that also have schizophrenia, and they deal with things completely differently. Catherine, she was working for... In her lifetime, she's had several different types of jobs. And at one point in her life, it sort of just became too much. She does, and at different times, have had different voices in her own mind that she's had to not only recognize were there, that they were real to her, that they wouldn't just go away. This is something that she had to form a plan within herself and a way forward that she can live with them. This is not something that, you know, this is not a, this is how you overcome. Absolutely nothing like that. And that's sort of one of the main things that we wanted to talk about. It's very important to know that. This is a progression. This is not a simple solution. This is how I did it, and this is how you do it. Absolutely not. It's a struggle every day, and I think it's how she, what she accepts for herself and what she progresses with, what she can live with. You know, because at certain points, she couldn't live with it. She couldn't live with it. She went through some really dark times, and only through learning and her own sort of absorbing all the information that she could about what she was going through, and learning how to not only keep the voices at bay, as it were, because that is one thing we do talk about, but how to kind of get along with them as well. It's not just, you know, okay, put them, sweep them under the carpet. It's not about that. It's kind of how do all these facets in my mind work together, so that we can, you know, can walk forward.
That's very, very well put. Is there a message in that film that you'd like people to kind of take away when they watch it as part of the festival?
Absolutely. Well, I think that in particular, yes, this is not, there's never or not nothing that I've found or we're trying to do in this film that says, this is how you deal with it. This is the right, this is the formulaic path to take. If you have this disease, this is what you should do. Absolutely not. She wants to say the same thing. I know this, Catherine. It is what works best for you. And the other thing is, she really wanted to let other people know that when you're feeling that down and that kind of desperate and not knowing, because there were certain times in her life, of course, she felt like that. And we all have probably at some point in our lives. There is a way forward, there is a way out, and, you know, unfortunately, mutual friends of ours didn't do that, and there, you know, you don't want to just think that it's, there's no way out, there is always some sort of an alternative, no matter how bad things can be, and she's a really great role model for people who have been incredibly down and out in times in their lives and have pushed past that, massive hurdles, and have come out the other side.
So you've got another film, haven't you, that you've been working on? It's called, it's about a guy involved in punk, and there's got a kind of he was diagnosed with HIV, if I remember rightly. So just tell us about that, because I know he was got diagnosed during the 1980s.
Yes.
So.
Yeah, his name is Matt Sargent. He's been with bands such as Sham 69, Chelsea. He's a bassist, so he's played with several bands. Another sort of very inspirational story to me. I think all of these, you know, when I think these stories find me rather than me going out and finding them, because I absolutely, you know, want to know more about these particular people. And he's definitely one of them. When he got diagnosed with HIV, it was 80s. It was late 80s. It was a death sentence. So at the time, people just, you know, wanted to run a mile, and he was told he had 3 years to live.
People didn't really know what it was either. They were kind of it was a bit of a scramble, wasn't it, to kind of find out what it actually was.
Was it a, you know, they called it the gay disease, you know, was it just with homosexual men? Was it, you know, where was it coming from? Who had it? How did you get it? And everybody went on lockdown, sort of. I mean, I remember Matt saying when he went home, he was 17 years old when he found out, okay, trying to develop his music career as a child, really. And at this point, he was in Sweden. He found out in Sweden. So very, you know, they were very just worried. And they almost wanted to quarantine him, really. Now he left and he came back to England. But when he came back to England, his mom didn't know what to do. His mom, they were using separate knives, forks, just as precaution. And I mean, the film's got a lot of heavy themes, actually. How Matt came to acquire the disease was he was groomed from somebody who was saying he was very heavy into the music industry at that time as well.
Yeah.
And because Matt wanted this so much as a child and throughout his entire life, this was what he was meant to do.
Yeah.
He went along with whatever this man was saying. This man had HIV, and that's how it was passed along to Matt. So not only is the film about HIV itself, it's also about pedophilia. And it's also about music and what the music industry is like and how good points and bad points, of course. And Matt has been playing music his entire life. I mean, the one thing he did really want to achieve, he has done, you know. And we got a great time filming with him as well for the past 3 years, more or less, have been going up to London, meeting all these incredible rock stars and you know, old school punk musicians and reggae and all different musicians taking us into their homes and telling me what it was like for them growing up in the music scene and also knowing what Matt was struggling with.
Okay, we'll leave it there for now. Yep. We'll return to that in the second half. Sure. Anyway, so thanks a lot, Stephanie, for that, and we'll catch up again in the second half.
Of course. Thanks.
So I'm back here with Stephanie De Palma, who for The Vote, the filmmaker. We were talking about Like There's No Tomorrow, the film before in the first half. So just tell us a bit more about that then. And was it successful, or how widely shown was that film?
Well, actually, it's not entirely finished yet. So it's going to be the end of this year. It's been about 3 years in the making now. And and honestly, I think it's just gone on because there's just, you know, you shoot something, there'd be another sort of wide open door. They think, okay, we have to explore that. We've been to Sweden to shoot. We've been all around London. We've met so many people with it. And I think that, we will definitely be finished by the end of this year for sure. And then hopefully off to the festival circuit. That's my plan with it. And it's just, we want to get it right. We want to get it right because there's, like I said, it's about pedophilia. It's also about HIV and the difference in what HIV meant then in the 80s to what it means to us now. We also have one of the top doctors in the UK speaking, and that is Matt's doctor, speaking about the, you know, still misconceptions. There's things now to this day. But it's very interesting to me. I have friends, I think we all do, who have been in that situation before. Yeah. And that sort of thinking then, from their point of view, from our point of view, it has changed. And thankfully it has. But, you know, there's still, you'd be very surprised to see what misconceptions still are here to this day.
Yeah.
And yeah, so the film really does touch on some important things, so we really want to get it right.
Yeah.
And I think that's why it's taken as long as it has to make, but it will be finished this year.
And people have come out of as HIV positive fairly recently, haven't they? So there is a lot more understanding, but there's still that kind of stigma as well, isn't there, in some parts of the community. So,
absolutely.
So you're hoping to combat that, I'm guessing, and that's going to be the message behind the film.
Definitely. Yeah. And I think, you know, Brighton is one of the most, we're very fortunate here because, you know, people with issues like that, with illnesses such as HIV, you do get a lot of help here.
Yeah.
And almost no questions asked. And I think that kind of community is just amazing. So you don't see that everywhere, you know? So I think with this film as well, putting it out here, I wouldn't want to put it out anywhere else but Brighton. So I want to really promote it here in Brighton, to also as a bit of a thank you for the things that are offered here within the Brighton community.
How do you pick your subjects then? Is it the things that play in your mind and you think, oh, that would make a good film? And how does a filmmaker go about choosing their subject?
Well, I think I'm sure it's different for everybody, but for me, they chose me. They definitely chose me. These people were introduced to me for no other reason other than you meet a lot of people. and each film that I've done wasn't by accident. Definitely, I just thought, wow, these people are absolutely incredible, you know. And I took it upon myself to tell their story. Sometimes with a little convincing, you know, because it's not something that they sought out. No one that I've done films about. But I said, look, I really think, you know, what you're doing is incredible, and we could show it in a light that I think, you know, obviously, other people will as well.
Yeah. So I know you've made another film called The Boss Lady,
yes,
which is another interesting subject, right? So BDSM.
BDSM.
So
I have to say, I am very proud of that one because of a couple of reasons. For one thing, Dimitri Adom was who the film was about. Now this is an incredible lady. From the minute I met this lady, I just thought, wow, like, what a force of nature. What an absolute force of nature. She made me feel like empowered just by a five minute meeting with her. I thought,
yeah,
I've got to get to know her more. So I did. Yes, it is about BDSM. Again, it's similar to like There's No Tomorrow as well. It's kind of squelching some of those ideas that we have about, you know, what we don't know. It's a small fraction of people possibly who practice BDSM, right? Yeah,
probably more than what we think.
Probably more than what we think. That's why I say possibly. Yeah. Possibly, but as I did more research on it, I got to realize, well, no, actually, quite a few more do.
But not really spoken about.
Not really spoken about. Yeah. So I was incredibly fortunate as well to have some of her clients open up to me because they had on camera,
yeah,
where they had never opened up to anybody before in some cases. So of course this is very, very delicate, and how you can see in the film some people physically you could tell exactly who that person was in their normal street clothes or what have you. Other people, no, not so much. But they wanted to tell how Demetria and their relationship with that person, with Demetria, had absolutely lightened up their entire world. She was the first person that they could talk to, or to get that release out that they hadn't felt with anybody else.
Yeah.
But there were other facets of their life and other people in their life that didn't necessarily know about this. So, yes, some of them were on camera. Yes, some of them didn't look exactly like they would in, you know, normal day-to-day life. But they still wanted to get their two cents in about what BDSM really is all about and what it did for them and what she did for them.
Yeah, and she unfortunately passed away, it last year?
Yes, last year.
Yeah.
And it was shocking to everyone. And because honestly, everyone that knew her, she it sounds a bit cheesy to say, I suppose, but she really did affect them in different ways. I mean, she really was an inspiration to everybody that she met. And everybody, even now, I mean, we talk about it. And that's one thing as well. I'd really like to do a screening of The Boss Lady again. This is something that myself and a couple of her friends and some of the players have been talking about. It's been just over a year now, and a commemoration again to her. And I'd really love to screen The Boss Lady again. And definitely within, I'd say, I'd love to do it by the end of November.
Yes.
Yes, we did it in the Marlborough Theater to start the very first day. It was packed. It was absolutely packed out. We had people sitting in the aisles because we didn't have enough seats.
Yeah.
And that's the kind of love she kind of put out there, and people loved her back.
Maybe this is a place to do it. So
I would love to. need to talk about. I would love to do it here. Yeah.
Just before we finish up, what have you got planned for the future? Then what does the future hold for you? Films you hope to make?
Okay, well, absolutely, like There's No Tomorrow. Like I say, we want that film out by the end of this year. And actually, I believe it's December 1st is National AIDS Awareness Day. So if we can do that by then, excellent.
Yeah.
Again, not rushing anything, but I want that one done by the end of this year for sure. And then promoting it as much as possible, putting it out there as much as possible because it's so important. And then the other one that I'm very excited about, I'm going to take a little step back from documentary to do a fiction short with Pete Bennett, who is a great character and winner of Big Brother 2006. And he's just a very talented guy.
He's got Tourette's, isn't he?
Yes, he's got Tourette's.
Wow.
Which now actually he's managed again. Somebody living with his own, what he has to overcome and how he did it. But that's not about this. This is a very fictional film. He's now doing a he has a spot with a Catherine Tate, a new new movie that's coming out as well. Okay. So things are really taking off for him, and he's such a talented guy.
Yeah.
And I'm pushing the boundaries out for myself because I wanted to play around with some fictional fun things with him in the making. So that one's going to be called Death to Fizzy Pop.
Okay.
And that's for next year, beginning of next year.
Yeah, okay. I should say, I mean, I remember Pete very well. He did a lot to raise awareness about about Tourette's, didn't he? So you kind of choose subject matter whereby, which paints a positive image of that particular issue, right?
Of course, yeah, absolutely. And I know Pete, and we've talked about this as well, anything that we do together, we want to sort of put back into... He does so much work still with Tourette's.
Yeah.
And to give more back
and
to...
And he lives in Brighton, I think.
He does. He splits his time now between Bristol and Brighton.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Just for finish up, anything you... kind of a burning issue you think that would make a good film?
A burning issue that, well...
it's probably quite a few, but...
Yeah, it's quite a few, but, I mean, for me, being an American, I know this is very... I don't, necessarily want to get into all the politics of things right now, but, with immigration and with Trump and our lovely president, I've got a burning issue.
Yeah.
Him.
Okay.
And the... Right. Unbelievable fact that he's even in the presidency. And for me, pinpointing something which is so personal to me as well is immigration and what the atrocities that have come surrounding immigration since he's been there.
Okay, we'll leave it there. That seems a good place to finish up. So thanks for coming in,
Thank you.
Stephanie, and all the best in the future.
Thanks, Mark.
Thank you.
Cheers.